Welcome to part three of The Fool in Shakespeare. We're going to talk about the fool in Shakespeare's history plays, specifically the Henry plays. I'm going to talk about Falstaff and Hal most of this, the mad majesty of Hal. As I talked about in the video on the tragedies, the fool is a way of preserving your values and surviving when all the society is being ruptured and being turned upside down, and restore them. We're going to see that in Hal. In the state of England during the history plays, it starts with Richard II. Now, Richard II, he just assumed monarchy was inherent in himself. Okay, he assumed the divine right of kings, which meant he doesn't need to criticize himself. He's not there because of consent of the governed. After Shakespeare showed all these things in his plays, and then Locke's like, maybe we shouldn't just assume the king is God's gift to everybody. And then the first British Civil War, then 100 years later, they had the second British Civil War, AKA the American Revolution. The idea of taking down this idea of inborn automatic royal values. Anyway, we get to see that shaking already in Richard II, where he assumes monarchy is inherent in himself, and he doesn't have a fool. Richard II doesn't have a fool, and there's no foolishness around him to humble him, which, unsurprisingly, he then surrounds himself with sycophants, with flatterers, and he doesn't see Bolingbroke, Henry Bolingbroke, later Henry IV, he doesn't see him coming. He doesn't see him as a possibility. In that play, Henry IV, or Henry Bolingbroke, does depose Richard II. He does it with public support, something that Richard really hadn't paid attention to, because again, divine right of kings, I can do what I want. However, as we see articulated more thoroughly in Hamlet, if the king gains the throne through a rotten means, it turns the whole nation or the whole world rotten. Henry IV replacing Richard II didn't just delegitimize Richard II's throne, it delegitimized all traditional perspectives on what gives the king a right to rule. Okay, is it blood? Is it popular support? Is it the church? Okay, is it just being Johnny on the spot? You're being in the right place at the right time. We don't know what makes a good king now. Thanks, Henry Bolingbroke. And it's actually that type of rupturing is the death of legitimate and clear and unanimously regarded kingship. It's actually like the death of God. It's the death in which, when Nietzsche said God is dead, he didn't mean that God, like, there once was an omniscient, omnipresent being and he died. What he meant is that the belief in such a thing, the shared belief of values, had been ruptured by the Protestant Reformation. If you question the legitimacy at all, it shows that the legitimacy of God is questionable. And then where are we going to find the truth then? That was a war that was going on during Shakespeare's lifetime. And I think that's something that informs the dramatic potential of his history plays, actually. Anyway, Hal is the heir to Henry IV, but he's growing up in a world where, like, okay, we don't know who's supposed to be the real king. Hal is stuck between two fathers, his actual father, Henry IV, and then Falstaff, Sir John Falstaff. Now, Henry IV is trying to legitimize and secure his place on the throne, but those who placed him on the throne, Northumberland, Harry Percy, Hotspur, they are now rebelling. Because if you can put a king on a throne, you can take him off one. That's the major plot of Henry IV Part 1, is this rebellion led by the same guys that put Henry IV on the throne. Meanwhile, Hal, our hero, he's getting drunk in the tavern with Sir John Falstaff. The exact opposite of what you would expect a prince to be doing, and definitely opposite what Henry Bolingbroke wants him to be doing. Now let's look at Falstaff. Falstaff is a really interesting creature in replacing his original plan of Sir John Oldcastle, who's the descendants of him had an issue with Shakespeare using him in the plays, so he had to cut that out. He replaces it with John Falstaff, or Fastolf, but now Falstaff. Shakespeare, Falstaff. All right. The fact that it's just about an anagram for Shakespeare's name, that should clue us off right off the bat that there's something special and something really, really interesting about this character. He's a knight. He's officially a knight. All right. But in actuality, he's a thief. He's a drunkard. All of the vices live in his gut. He's a fool, but he's also very witty. He is this prototype of the witty fool. It's interesting. He has the most scriptural references than any other Shakespeare character. All right, now that helps because he's in more plays than almost every Shakespeare character, except for Hal. The morally worst character in all of Shakespeare's plays, arguably, it has the most scripture references. Again, Shakespeare using a foolish character to kind of flip things. From his first scene, Hal says he's using Falstaff and his friends to actually obscure, to mask, to mislead people away from his own study of how to be a good king. He compares himself to the sun, who lets himself be obscured by clouds for a set period of time. Now, that we can read that in two ways. Is Hal the reluctant king who would rather spend time in the taverns, or is he like the guy who he's strategically trying to become the best king he can, but he needs to obscure his intentions and he needs to learn what the people want and stuff, or is it somewhere in between? I think it's somewhere in between there. He knows what he has to do, but at the same time he's able to love Falstaff, even though value-wise Falstaff is his enemy. Okay, we're going to talk about that in a little bit. Falstaff. Now, he wants and expects that when Hal reaches the throne, he's going to bring all of their group of thieves and drunkards and members of the tavern. He's going to bring them all up to court with him. But in reality, that would actually take all of those values of kingship that Hal is supposed to be assuming and bring them down to the level of the tavern, all right? It's actually a form of nihilism. In Falstaff, which he really shows that a bit later, it's actually a form of nihilism to say, to see no difference in value between the tavern and the throne room, and to want them to be at the same level. That actually is what places him as not only the opposite of King Henry IV, but also the opposite of Hal. We get to see Falstaff's disregard for traditional values, either of royalty or of chivalry and stuff, in the end of Henry IV, Part 1, in the battlefield, when he's looking at a dead body and he says, "There's honor for you." Okay, he gives this whole thing about, you know what, I don't want to be honorable if it kills me. Okay, this was an enormous, enormous revelation that Shakespeare gives us. And I think Falstaff contains a truth, if not many, that it took hundreds of years up until, I think, World War I before the British people really, before England really understood. And not just England, the whole, all of Europe, really understood what Shakespeare was showing us in Falstaff, is that all these chivalric values can be completely empty, especially to those who aren't living them out. I'm saying that just about Falstaff. I'm not commenting on people in World War I. But the idea, but the language is the same. The idea that this disregard for these values of chivalry and all this that really just end up in young men dying on the battlefield. And so this idea that Falstaff really shows us that these words mean really nothing, at least to him. Now, the fact that they mean nothing to him should not surprise us. So one might ask, how did Falstaff become this way? Where did he get his politics from? There's a veiled reference in Henry IV, Part 2, that he identifies that he grew up under Sir Thomas Mowbray. If you've read Richard II, you know in the first scene, there's actually a contention between Henry Bolingbroke, who later became Henry IV, and Sir Thomas Mowbray. Bolingbroke accuses Mowbray of killing the Duke of Gloucester, which is the uncle of Richard II. But everybody kind of knows, but no one's gonna say it openly, that Richard II had that done. He had Mowbray kill Gloucester to secure his place on the throne. So Bolingbroke is not only accusing Mowbray, he's also accusing Richard II. They end up doing a duel later on in the play, a joust, actually. But Richard stops it before it happens, and he declares, "Bolingbroke, you are banished for a few years, and Mowbray, you're banished forever." Thanks, Mowbray, all right, or thanks, King, rather. So it shouldn't surprise us that Falstaff, who grew up under the guy who secured the king's throne and then got banished for it, got punished for helping the king, it shouldn't surprise us that Falstaff sees all the things of chivalric values and honor and all the world that his boy Hal is going to go into as being dangerous and shifty and nothing. There's quite a lot more than drink behind that man, that man's face. But at the same time, he also plays the part of the butt of Hal's jokes. He's also recognizes this kid is the king, so I'm going to make him feel good. None of the jokes happen, they always happen at Falstaff's expense, not at Hal's expense. Is Falstaff actually as short-sighted and slightly witty, but also foolish as he is? Or does he know, like, I need to make this boy look good? And I don't mean that in a, like, that there's any shiftiness there, but it is an interesting set of politics, even in the taverns. At the end of Henry IV, Part 2, we get Hal's final rejection of Falstaff, okay, where he's in public and Falstaff's like, yeah, hey, Hal, my sweet boy. And Hal is like, I know thee not, old man. Again, many questions with Hal about, like, which side is he? Are we now seeing the real Hal, who has been holding on to this intention since Act 1, Scene 2 of Henry IV, Part 1? Or is this now the mask that he's putting to everyone outside, and he actually does love Falstaff? I don't think it's either or there. But it does show that officially Falstaff is the enemy or at least values-wise, he is the opposite of Hal's life. He is his actual foil. Now, Hal, as the one who is Prince, but he plays in the taverns, he is definitely the opposite of Hotspur. Where Hotspur thinks, like, oh, we need to live out the chivalric values, live them out, follow them through. But it ends badly for him, because he doesn't see Hal as dangerous. He doesn't see him as a formidable opponent. Hal ultimately likes Hotspur's values. He just needs to inculcate them in the right way. He doesn't want to be used. We can see that later on, that theme of the direct and good son in Laertes, who gets used by Claudius. Again, you got to be judicious about these things. The idea of being foolish or misdirecting people's perspective, either through being mad like Hamlet or being drunk like Hal, is actually a way of self-preservation when all the values of society are flipped over. Hal recognizes he's not endangered by Hotspur. It's Falstaff, the temptation not to try, the temptation to just remain in the taverns. That's, and to not give his life to restore the values of the throne, not just of Richard II, but of Edward III and Edward Black, Prince of Wales, who preceded Richard II. All right, and that's something that Hal shows us that Falstaff could never show. While he's rejecting Falstaff and needs to reject him, he is learning from him. He is figuring out, how can I be a king and learn from Falstaff? He learns how to pretend. He learns how to misdirect. He learns how to be witty. He learns how to be brave. All right, there's a lot of, it's really interesting schooling Shakespeare gives his Henry V, Prince Hal, and Henry V later, in the taverns. All right, it's brilliant. Hilarious stuff, while he's secretly also studying, right? We get to hear all of that about his transition in the first scenes of Henry V. Even as he rejects Falstaff, he still uses a lot of the things that he does, all right? It's easy to say, like, oh, the closer to the throne Hal gets, the less Hal he becomes, and the more he becomes Henry V. In my opinion, he's always Hal. And yes, he does have to place more emphasis on his political perspective. We don't get to hear the same Hal that secretly, when he's talking to Poins, he's like, man, I'm so tired. I wish I could just have some small beer. I don't need all the upper class drinks, all right? I just want some beer in a tavern. By the way, there's these wonderful moments of Hal. It says he can order beer with anybody, and they won't know that he's the prince. That's how well he has understood from top to bottom his society. Whereas Henry, he only kind of looked at the bottom for populism, and then Richard only looked at the top. Hal understands all of it, and he's doing something that Falstaff could never do. He is living out his virtues. That is what Hal does, and this, I think, is Shakespeare's taking the foolishness of Hal, meaning like the willingness to go down in value in order to preserve one's values. That's actually Shakespeare's answer, I think, to a time when all things seem to be ruptured, when we don't know which direction is up. Again, I talked about how the throne and the kingship has been delegitimized under Richard II and Henry IV. So what does Hal have to do? He has to resurrect the values of those who preceded Richard II. He has to embody them. Now, he actually lives out the chivalric virtues in his own life. He's not just pretending to them. And he experiences them as real in a way that a doubting Falstaff can't. He understands, and this is something that's really Aristotelian in Shakespeare's characters, or at least in Hal, he understands that virtues must be lived out and habitualized before they can be experienced. Okay, the Nicomachean Ethics says, by Aristotle, says that in order to be courageous, you have to do courageous things. Okay, you can't wait until you feel an inspiration of courage and then do something courageous. You have to do a bunch of little courageous things to build up the habit of courage, then you can be trusted with great courageous moments, all right? And expand that to any other of the virtues. And Hal understands that. That's why Falstaff is a nihilist in his values, because he doesn't live out any virtues. He's a man of the vices, so of course he sees no values. It's almost like I mean, later on in the tragedies, you see Macbeth. I mean, he lived out zero virtues, and that's why he says tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps into petty pace from day to day. He sees no value in any of the days. Well, yeah, because you killed all the values, Macbeth. But Shakespeare, with Hal, he actually lives out the values. And we get to see that in Henry V, when we really get to see what has he been preparing through these two tavern plays. Because his opponents, the French, the king of the French, he recognizes, he's like, I haven't seen anyone like him since I saw Edward III. All right, he's actually living out the values that have been killed by the previous two kings. Like Fortinbras in Hamlet, he restores not only the rightful kingship, he restores the structure of values to the nation around it. Still, I mean, wife and I were able to go over to York a few months ago, and I was talking to some guys in York Minster, and they were like, man, if I could meet King Henry, man, I'd say thank you. Like, they still love him, for good reason. He became something bigger than anyone had before him. To wrap all of this up, in Falstaff and Hal, Shakespeare, I think, even though they're not technically fools, okay, they both show us the way that foolishness and not taking yourself so seriously, indeed going into the opposite of one's values, can get you through a very difficult, tragic situations. Shakespeare's answer is not to play Hotspur and just try to force your values, the values that you have, and to completely resist the change. His answer might be Hal, and be honest about what is actually going on, what are the values that are being lost, and how can we restore them, how can we resurrect them, or leave them to be gone, all right? A lot is left behind with Henry IV, when Henry IV dies and Hal becomes Henry V. And that's, I think, something that foolishness in Shakespeare, it shows us that true virtue, and this is a great irony, that it's the thing that shows that true virtue cannot be delegitimized. The pretense at virtue can be. That's why Richard II falls and Henry IV falls. But actual virtue, it can go down into the tavern and be tested, and it can survive the worst places. So the idea of your values might be in the shadows. They might be in the opposite place of what you'd expect. And it's foolishness, it's humor and self-criticism, that those are the types of things that, even though they are the least comfortable things in the world, they can help us get through and manage and survive. Because real virtue cannot be illegitimized, even if it's taking a crown into a tavern. Okay, but again, doesn't stay in the tavern. Hal gains the throne, and he eventually gains even the support of his enemies. And it's brilliant, brilliant stuff. Thank you for sitting through all three of this discourse on Shakespeare's development of the fool. Of course, this is only the tip of the iceberg, and read these plays. They are amazing. And of course, once I get it published, check out my book, Sacred Shadows and Latent Light, which focuses on Henry IV, Part 1 and Part 2. Thank you, and have a great April Fool's Day.